policies globally is that it is based and it's driven by inequality. So what it rises, it's kind of, it exploits the weaker, and thereby, you know, women who are economically, politically, and socially weaker and more vulnerable, more marginalized, get to often bear the disproportionate burden of, you know, so-called liberalization of trade and investment. We've seen that. And the different types of agreements that you see actually perpetuate that inequality. For example, you know, in the developing countries, in the global south, women really depend on agriculture. They depend on informal services like retail. Like in India, retail is the second largest employer of women after agriculture. But we see that from the current trade liberalization framework, both from the WTO and the free trade trade and investment agreements, that these sectors are getting squeezed, you know, because they were supposed to be of advantage to small farmers, small players, and for developing countries, but we haven't seen that happen because of the way global power relations have been used. And so so in these sectors, these are getting squeezed and women are losing out. But at the same time, you see the new issues, the new areas that are kind of thriving under these trade agreements. Women do not have the wherewithal to do better there. Because, for example, look at intellectual property rights, which was not a trade issue, but it has now come under trade agreements. And women neither own the intellectual property because they don't have so much access to knowledge, to education, and to technology. And at the same time, they are losing out disproportionately from, for example, the, you know, the result of high medicine prices or increase in prices of agricultural inputs, where they really need these, but that access is getting compromised. Look at the investment agreements. I mean, they are threatening, for example, access to natural resources, which women really use. They are also threatening access to development policy and human rights, which again really hurts women more than men. And for example, you know, I saw that when I was talking about intellectual property rights and all, there are HIV affected women groups that I was talking to, and one of them told me that, for example, if the medicine is inaccessible, then the woman gives up the treatment. Mm-hmm. And these medicines have to be taken in a cycle. You should not break the cycle. But they ensure that the husband continues to take the treatment, but they do not get it. So the inequality really hurts them. And then there are areas like government procurement, government purchases, which are now being liberalized. And those were often tools used to, for example, give preferential treatment to women producers. So they are losing a lot of ground. And I think that's why we are very concerned that existing social inequalities, which are on gender lines, they are really increasing from this framework of trade and investment liberalization that we see today. I do wish I had an answer to that question, but I think one is to control the power at the top. You know, how do you build in more responsibility and accountability? Like, for example, the business and human rights discussion that's going on. How do you make the corporations that are so rich more transparent, more accountable? And the big corporations, they are determining policy worldwide, right? Like through these different types of agreement, whether it's in finance, it's in trade, in investment, they are controlling the policy. So how do you curb that huge, gigantic influence is one. And then, of course, we've been hearing it historically that you strengthen the weakest, but I really do not know because we haven't seen it over so many decades of this whole globalization that has come. But I think you build in more participation, more transparency, more democracy in all these systems, these different frameworks that drive these inequalities, I think, yeah. Major challenge that we are facing is that countries are losing their policy flexibility. So I think it's because they are getting tied to agreements and to binding rules which may not be working for them and for their people. So, in fact, the biggest advocates of trade liberalization do say that there has to be redistribution. But the countries are losing the policy flexibility to do that redistribution. So I think most important is to retain the policy flexibility so that a country can design its own trade agreement or trade relationships for each point in their development path, you know, because it's not going to be the same when they're a very poor country, and when they move up the development path, they'll be producing different set of goods, so they'll have different set of skills. So they need to have that. And secondly, they must have the policy flexibility to address these inequalities that different social classes face when they are engaging or when they are made to engage. You know, they will ultimately be affected. And when they are affected by these trade liberalizations, governments must have the policies to be able to address those inequalities. I think that's crucial. And in terms of process, we have seen one major thing, I think, as a framework to have an overriding human rights framework. Everything else must be subservient to that, that you recognize that that is your primary framework and nothing gives you the power to violate a certain human rights framework, which should include the right to development for developing countries. And it's not only for countries, it's for citizens.